large stave split from the wood, the log. This is a piece of ash. Bows, for the most part, are made out of hickory. We're going to try to do these out of ash because it's a really small one, a 4-inch bow. But if you read in books or do a little studying, it was hickory, ash, and ironwood, which they claimed to use, you know, years back. I'm sure you could use white oak and other species of oaks as well, just as long as it's got a straight grain and it's easy to work. So once we have the sapwood, we can't use anything but heartwood. Bark has to be on it, because what's going to happen is the outside of the bend of the bow is going to include the bark, and that protects the wood from splitting. And we'll show you two examples of that here in a second, on one that has bark on it, what that does, and then one that doesn't, and you can see that. So we're just gonna split it. I'm not gonna get into individual sizes and dimensions for every size of bow that you need, but you just go by the size and you rough it out. So right now this one is a little too wide. I'm gonna get it back to about 1.5 inches squared off on the end. So I'm gonna take some of the inside sapwood off. And when we're dealing with this, we just split it. And you'll know when you have a good piece, because it just should pop and split like that. Now it has to be really clear. This we can use for something later. So as we go along, we're going to inspect it. You can have some knots on this end. This one has some worm damage, but I think we'll be okay there. I don't see any major knots, especially in the center piece where you're going to bend it. It needs to be nice and clear. If there's any imperfections, you'll do all the work and then it's gonna snap or break. So you wanna make sure that you take your time looking at it. Again, overall lengths, rough widths and dimensions, use a dimension guide. But this will apply, what I'm showing you will apply for basically getting a blank going so that then you can steam it and bend it. Just mentioned to you why we keep the bark on it, and this is a finished bow. So you can see the bark runs almost the entire length of this one, but it really needs to stay on about halfway, all the way through the bend. And what that bark does is that protects the sapwood from splitting and coming apart. Now, sometimes the bark comes off, sometimes it separates a little bit and you can epoxy it back on. These actually, I had to glue a little bit back on. You can see here where we had some damage. But even if you glue it back on or epoxy it, and it'll mainly be right around the bend here where you'll have to do that if it does separate, it's still gonna protect it for a lot of years. And that's really why we're keeping the bark on it. It looks nice, but it also, again, it keeps that from splitting. The bark is more flexible. So here's one that did not have the bark stay on it. You can see the bark stayed on the sides and it came off the center portion. Now, this bow is about 30 years old and this is in the yoke that I use every day. Just as the oxen angels hate it when they see PVC bows, we also hate it when we see electrical tape. Sometimes electrical tape's not necessary, guys. We see bows taped up all the time. This, again, is a bow that has been used for 30 years, doesn't have the bark on it, and I've never had any major problems with it. Now, that's not to say at some point or even earlier on it may split and you want to tape it up, but don't use electrical tape if you don't have to on whips and bows. Try it the way it was intended originally back hundreds of years ago, and then if you have to use that modern stuff, use it. But so you can see that they will work both ways, and I'm not going to say this is an example every time without bark on it, it'll always hold up, but in the case where I have bows that don't have bark, they have. So you can see the reason for it, and here's an old bow. And I've got as many old bows that are 20, 30 years old that have the bark on them that are still good condition. As long as you keep up your equipment, they'll last forever. Once we've roughed it out, you can see it's not square, but you'll get it pretty darn close just by splitting it if you've got a decent piece of wood. We're gonna use draw knife. That's all we're gonna use. It only takes a minute or two. And we're gonna square it off all the way down from the top to the bottom. Get yourself a clamp or something to hold it in, then flip it over and finish the rest. And we're just going to square it off to the rough dimensions that we need. The rough dimensions are going to be different depending on the size of the bow. After a minute or two of working it with the draw knife, you can see I got it not quite squared. I'd go a little bit more with this, but just for the purposes of showing you, you can get it perfectly squared with the draw knife so that then your end is good and square. And once we find the center, we're gonna go out whatever the dimensions require. This should be throughout the whole bend. So if this is a 5-inch yoke or a bow or a 9-inch bow, obviously that bend will be bigger. So we wanna measure out the entire radius. So let's just say for this one, it's right here. And then we'll just measure the same over there. And what we're going to do is we're then going to take the rasp and work this down thinner and just round it off. So we'll show you how to do that next. In any yokes or bows, this is one of the handiest tools you can have. It's a SureForm rasp. This one has the flat blade. The rounded blades are what you would use for shaping the necks of yokes or any inside radius. And I typically use that on shaping a bow as well. But I broke my last one. They do break, the more time you have in using them. So keep a couple extra spares on you. But for any shaping of yokes or bows or finish work, these things come in super handy. You can buy them at any hardware store. You're just gonna have a really hard time finding the half round blades. Those you have to get off Amazon. I haven't found them anywhere here locally at least, but the flat blades you can find pretty much everywhere. That we work this down, the more radius it'll have. And you can go pretty thin here. So like if we start with about 1.5 inches, which is what this is, I can be down close to 1 inch on this radius. Okay, and actually the thinner it is, the easier it's theoretically it's going to be to bend once you steam it. So you can see just a few minutes with that rasp, I can take out quite a bit more material here, but I'll show you one that's done. And all we want is a half moon this way, keep the ends square, and then after we bend it, we'll just finish up the bows and shape them so that they fit into the yoke holes. Here's our finished blank bow. So you saw how this is all I did was shave it off or shape it with the draw knife just to get it square after we made a stave and split it. So it's about, this is a 4-inch, it's about 1.25 inches square. And you just need to have enough size left in the stick to when you round it out, it's gonna be the right size, all right? You can see that we left the bark on. We shaved a little bit of the bark off right in the middle where we're going to bend it. Again, the reason for the bark is to keep it from splitting. And that just kind of protects the outside as we bend it. And then, as you saw, I took the rasp and just rounded out the centerpiece. Now you can start rounding out the rest of it if you want. The way that I'm doing it on the pegboard gives us a little bit more grip on the pins and the pegs if it's square. So we're gonna steam this, probably steam it for about 1/2 hour or until we start seeing some bubbles coming out between the bark and the sapwood, right in that area. You don't wanna oversteam it or understeam it. And this one's been soaking for a while too, just to keep it pliable in water. So we're gonna steam it and see if it'll bend. So here's our jig. This is a bit of a do-it-yourselfer for bows. Now there's several different ways that you can do this. This is something that I just threw together for this particular bow because it's a 4-inch, it's kind of small. You could create this so that the patterns here, the molds for the bow to go around, this one is 4 inches wide. They could be obviously any size. And you could make this so that these are interchangeable, but I have it bolted in here for now. So the idea behind this is get a good, solid, large enough hardwood piece of plank. You've got your pattern here in the middle. This will give you your arc for your bow with the correct width. And then what I did is I put peg holes all the way down from one angle down to the other. And then there's a pin in the center which should hold the bow in the center so it doesn't pop up.
So you have to make sure that that's the correct width for the bow that we made. And then you can put one pin on one side, because this we're gonna do a little bit of an old fashioned way. Now, again, you can use all kinds of different machines and come-alongs and stuff, and those work great. Pegboards like this really seem to be kind of the traditional way of making a bow. And a lot of times if you went to an old barn, you'd kind of see some of these pegboards on the side of a barn. They'd be bolted right to the barn, and that's how they would make their bows, and they would just have interchangeable pieces in the center. So the idea is to stick the bow in through here so that the end of it is up against this. After you steam it, slowly take a pipe or something to pull it down and form its shape. And then we can take a pin or a bolt, we'll use a bolt. And then as we go along, we're just gonna pin it so that it doesn't spring back until we get to our final hole, and then we'll tie it off. Now, in order for this to work, you have to have it mounted really solidly. So we'll take a look at that, and then we'll take a look at making the bow. Close here to bending it. So I've got some bolts. I'm just using these bolts as pins. So I got three ready so that I can pin it over. You also need just a small stick, the width of the bow. So this is a 4-inch bow. So this will go under here. And as we bend it around and we tie it off, this will keep that radius the right width, and it'll give it some strength until it sets and dries up. So you need those things ready and some string to tie it off, and some gloves, because we're going to be taking out of the steamer hot. So we're going to do that next. Let's go over to our jig. Now, if you have a bigger bow, and even on this one, it wouldn't hurt if you have a piece of pipe or just something that you can get more leverage on, we're gonna try to do it without that. We have the center mark. We're gonna put it in the center of the form. I've got my pins here that we're going to use, and we're just gonna slowly bend it over. This is working. We've got some splitting going on, but you can kind of see the idea. So let's pin it there, and then we'll go on this side. One thing that'll help is if we have a wedge. Okay. And keep bending it this way. Slow. That wedge will keep it in the right shape. And then once we get all the way over, I'm just gonna pin it to keep it in place. And then we're gonna do the same thing on this side again. And you can see I've got my piece of wood in the middle here, and that's gonna help keep its form. All right, so now we have the basic shape of a bow, and we're gonna tie it off. Now, in some cases, if you get in there and you need to, like if this pops out or anything, get a pipe clamp and just start clamping it up here or down here. This one's small enough to where we're just going to use a piece of string, made a loop on one end. We've got our piece of wood here that's 4 inches to stabilize it, and we'll just draw it in the rest of the way. You can overbend it just a little bit so that it keeps its shape, and then tie this off. Tie a knot in here. And this one split pretty bad, but you get the idea. Take a look at our end result. Again, this one ain't pretty, but you get the idea on how it works, and that was not difficult to do. If you have access to good straight grain, hickory or ash or white oak, you can make fairly quickly, very inexpensively, and without a whole lot of trouble, a bow. So you can see here, this is very typical what can happen. I tape this up just so that it stays in place, and what we'll do is we'll epoxy this and put everything back together after. It'll be a usable bow. It's hit or miss. A lot of it, I think, depends on, if you ask the old timers, when the tree was harvested, how much sap is in it, the time of year, you know, all the way up to what side of the mountain the tree was growing on, as to how well it'll bend. And then you have to steam it.
Not to overcomplicate things too much, but after this sits for a week or two and it's nice and dry, the next step will be to fit it to a yoke. This is where the inside dimension is very important, making sure that your original form is the right dimension, 4, 5, 6, 8, 10 inches, whatever it is. So then finishing them, we start with a kind of a squared off rough bow like we looked at before after we just bent that. This is a 6 inch. And then we take the rasp that we looked at earlier, or a flapper disc on an angle grinder, and a spoke shave, and you start rounding it out. So you get a round shape, making sure that you pay attention to this dimension between to make sure that it stays the right dimension. So this is a 6 inch single yoke right here. Dimension when I started, 6 inches between, and I want to keep an eye on that. Now, as I shape it and round it out, I'm going to stick it into the yoke holes and make sure that it's nice and smooth, and then both should fit and go up as high as I need it to into the yoke. And you'll see this really takes some of the most time when you're finishing the bow, just to make it round and fit. So you'll push it in, you'll pull it out, it'll get bound up, and you'll see where the yoke will actually mark against the bow, and then you'll have to take a little material out where it's too wide, and then you fit it in. It's just, it takes time, and taking a little bit of material off at a time, pushing in and out. And then what you determine is if you have another yoke or an animal that you can make a dimension off of, and how deep you want to go with the bow holes for the bow key. You know, it's as simple as just marking the center, drilling it nice and straight with the drill, and then finishing it off with any sort of washer and a pin, which would be the last step, just to sand everything down. And there's your finished product. You can chamfer the tops and the edges, and you can drill as many holes as you want. Just making sure they're spaced out enough to where they don't get too close.